Listening Library presents The Red Blazer Girls, The Ring of Rocamadour by Michael D. Beil. Read for you by Ty Alexandra Ricci. Chapter 1, in which I enter an alternative universe where burly men read Cosmo and giant house cats roam sacred corridors. For as far back as I can remember, I have told everyone I know that I am going to be a writer. And it's not just some idle dream. I have been a busy girl, and my hard drive is bulging with the results of this ambition, a heaping assortment of almost but not quite finished short stories, and at least three, this time I'm really off to a great start, and I mean it, novels. Unfortunately, every single thing I have written, until now that is fatally flawed. Write what you know, everyone told stubborn little me. Very good advice that I completely ignored. Instead, I wrote and wrote, filling my stories to the brim with people and places I have spent my life reading about instead of the people and places that are my life. But all that changed the moment I looked out the window in Mr. Elliott's English class and screamed. Suddenly, I had my very own story. My tale begins in September, my first month in the upper school at St. Veronica's on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. I know, it sounds snobby, like one of those schools in the movies or TV, but trust me, it's not. Believe me, I'm not rich, and my friends aren't either. St. V's is just a nice, ordinary all-girls school that just happens to be in a pretty expensive neighborhood. Yes, we wear plaid skirts with our lovely red blazers. And yes, there are a few nuns running around the place. But there are no limos parked outside or helicopters on the roof or anything like that. We are just starting Great Expectations in Mr. Elliott's English class, taking turns reading aloud from the first chapter. So Leanne Hymas is reading. Someday, Leanne, a very passionate reader, will win an Academy Award. When she reads, it's like one of those fabulous A Star is Born auditions for a Broadway play. Great Expectations, the greatest novel ever written, per our Mr. Elliott, starts off with this spooky scene. As a cold early evening fog hangs over a churchyard cemetery, the poor little orphan Pip is wandering near his parents' headstone. As Leanne pours her heart into every word, I'm picturing the mist hanging over the graves, worn smooth by the passage of time. I feel the chilly, clammy air, hear the trees creaking and swaying in the wind. And so there I am, perched on the edge of my seat, when Leanne reads, "Hold your noise," cried a terrible voice as a man started up from among the graves at the side of the church porch. "Keep still, you little devil, or I'll cut your throat." I gasp loudly. Leanne, along with everyone else in the room, spins around to look at me. "Everything all right, Miss St. Pierre?" Mr. Elliott asks, peering over his glasses and trying to hold back a smile. Mr. Elliott is one of those teachers who is basically cool, but still a total geek, always making really corny jokes that only he gets. His first name is George, which explains a lot. Get it? George Eliot? Like the novelist. Except that George Eliot was really a woman named Mary Ann Evans. Oi! I blush, just a little. I'm fine. Thanks for asking, though. Always keep them guessing, that's what I say. He nods to Leanne to continue. Across the room, my best friend, Margaret Vrobel, has this huge smile on her face. She mouths the words, "deep breaths," at me, which is what she always tells me when I get too excited, or too scared, or too anxious, or too anything. I'm a very emotional person. I just don't seem to have that whatever gene. Everything matters in my world. Margaret reads next, and her version of Charles Dickens is flavored with a soupçon of a Polish accent, a remnant of the first 7 years of her life in the suburbs of Warsaw. My eyes drift off for a moment, turning to the stained glass windows and the gray stone walls of St. Veronica's Church, separated from the school by a courtyard that is maybe 20 or 30 feet wide. And then I scream. And this time, I am at least as startled as everyone else in the room, with the possible exception of poor Mr. Elliot. Sophie, for crying out loud! I know it's an exciting book, but please try to control yourself. I'm sorry, Mr. Elliot, but I saw... I point out the window at the church, but the thing that had been so scream-worthy is gone. Yes? Nothing. I thought I saw something, but it must have just been a pigeon. My gosh, what was this pigeon doing? The bell rings. Yay! And I gather my books quietly and glance furtively out the window, hoping to get a second look at what I had seen for just the briefest flash. Margaret and I walk to the locker we share. So what was that all about? She demands, after we get away from the crowd outside the room. I saw something, I whisper. Something like dead people? Margaret whispers back. Rebecca Chen sticks her head between Margaret and me. What's going on? Why are we whispering? Sophie says she saw something scary out the window during English class. She actually screamed. Rebecca's interest level increases immediately. You screamed? In class? Cool. I saw a face in the window. That little round one in the church? Come on, I'll show you. We return to the now empty room 503 and recreate the scene. I was sitting right here, and just for a split second, I saw it, plain as day. A woman's face, really pale, almost white, with long white hair. You dozed off, says Rebecca. It was a dream. No, I was wide awake. You know how sometimes you're sitting there with the remote and you're flipping through the channels as fast as you can? But every once in a while, you see something. Something you recognize. Like a cute guy. Or a scene from your favorite episode of Seinfeld or whatever. And even though you only saw it for, like, a split second, you still take it in? Well, that's what it was like. Sophie, we're on the fifth floor, Margaret says. That means we're 40 feet up. That window is above us. It's probably just an attic or something. Sorry, but it's pretty unlikely that there was an old lady at that window. Unless it was a ghost. Rebecca is getting more excited by the minute. Or someone trapped. Or being held in a secret room like in The Man in the Iron Mask. Margaret, the smartest person I know, can't resist an opportunity for a good literary illusion. Or maybe she's in the church seeking sanctuary, like Quasimodo. You know, the Hunchback of Notre Dame. A couple of years ago, Margaret's dad salvaged a complete set of the Harvard classics that some moron in their building had put out with the trash. Margaret has made it one of her missions in life to read all 70 volumes. Guys, I'm serious. I know you don't believe me, and I don't blame you, but I swear I saw her. And, the weird part is, even though I only saw her for a second, I got the strangest feeling that she was trying to say something to me. Like what? Rebecca asks, eyes wide. Like she needed help or something. I wait for them to scoff. Look, Soph, I know you well enough to know you wouldn't scream unless you saw something. So if you say you saw her, we believe you. Don't we, Rebecca? Rebecca looks dubious but goes along. Okay. I mean, yes, absolutely. I believe you. Do you believe I'm starving? Can we go to lunch now? Come on, Beck, lunch can wait. We have a mission. I have a granola bar in my bag. It's full of oaty, nutty goodness, and it's all yours. Really? You think we should go right now? I can pass up lunch, especially a school lunch, for a little adventure. Why wait? If it is a ghost, this could be the one day in the year that she shows herself. You know, like the anniversary of the day she was murdered. We have to go, now. Rebecca positively lights up at the mention of murder. Okay, you guys, but I have to be back in time for English. I walked in 10 seconds after the bell yesterday, and Mr. Smelliot gave me the stink eye. I don't think he likes me. We have lots of time, Margaret replies. 35 minutes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.